Welcome to the Standing Committee on Finance for Monday, October 17th. Councilors, items one and two were inadvertently placed on the agenda. Those are the appointments of the firefighters that we took care of last week. Councilor Azak.
Mr. President, a moment of personal privilege, please.
You may.
Okay.
We say you can go down there?
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Here with Councilor Ann Beauregard, and we would like to recognize two amazing women that are in the audience here with us tonight. One of them is a Ward 7 constituent, Lucia Shannon. Do you want? Present Lucia with a citation for her dedication to our community. Lucia was recognized at the State House this past summer for Unsung Heroine Award, so I felt that the city of Brockton should also celebrate her. So thank you for all you do, Lucia. We're very proud to have you be part of our community.
Thank you, Shirley. Thank you. I have enjoyed my nearly 42 years of working for the city of Brockton. It's a fabulous city, and there's been a lot of wonderful moments I've had. I've enjoyed the public very much. I've had fun with some of these city councilors, as they know. We did a couple of murder mysteries at the Brockton Public Library, and I have loved living in the city, and I love your mom. She's one of our great patrons. I started back in 1974, and one of my library patrons used to use the library when it was at the City Hall. So I have been here a very, very long, long time, and I will miss it. But I've made friends with people at the COA, and in my way of thinking, that's heaven on earth, and I'm enjoying the wonderful people there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
We have another award this evening for a woman that is an unsung heroine, and we're going to try to pronounce her last name here. This is Linda Pietrantonio. I came close here. Linda, I wanted to come up here. Linda sits around with a good group of people that keep the city clean, actually, whether they're cleaning a playground, streets, and organizing different events that take place. She works with a lot of hardworking individuals, and one of them comes to mind right now is Lynn Smith. But Linda does a whole lot on her own, too. There's never a project she thinks is too big or small, and she's such an asset to have in the community, and I was pleased that we would follow in the footsteps and recognize her here in Brockton as they did in the State House. So congratulations, Linda.
I'm not good at speaking, but I want to thank everybody for this, and I enjoy working for the city, and we have a great group of people that help. You know, thank you.
Thank you to these two amazing women, but I can't not recognize one that's sitting here in the front row with them. It's her birthday, Donna Jones, who's also an amazing unsung heroine. So, what do you say?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ranieri.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, I just want to take a moment of personal privilege, and I want to direct it to you as our chairman this evening, but as our president as well. And I want to take the opportunity to welcome you to the 60-man's club. It's about time that you've joined the rest of us as we start to age, and welcome you to the new process. But in any case, I do want to wish you a belated but a very happy, healthy birthday. And I know you had a nice get-together over the weekend with your family and friends. So best wishes to you for many more years.
Now I can be a cranky old man, so behave. Exactly. Over that. Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. President, I'm going to make a motion. We take agenda item 7 out of order.
Yes.
Second.
Motion yes. Made and seconded. Take item number 7 out of order. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, please read item number 7.
Resolved that Mr. Matt O'Brien, Mr. Bill Keane, and Mr. Joe Berolini, representatives of the West Cal Ripken Baseball League, FKA West Little League, be invited to appear before the Finance Committee to discuss the history of the Albert Baroncelli baseball field and the need and desire to have a new baseball field constructed to meet the needs of the youth within our city. Invited Matt O'Brien, representatives of the West Cal Ripken Baseball League, Mr. Bill Keane, and Mr. Joe Berolini.
Thank you.
Mr. President, if I could, councilors, those that are new to the council, I just want to let you know a quick history on this. I've been on the council 11 years, and this is an issue that I've been talking about, I think, since that time. Mostly during the budget hearings, I bring this up. Full disclosure, I have two sons that play in the West League, and the reason why I wanted to bring these gentlemen before us tonight is really, first of all, thank you to the boys and girls that are here and their parents that brought them. This is an issue that is unique to, I call it West Little League, but it's the West Cal Ripken League. Not to slight any other leagues within the city, but a promise was made. If you kind of fast forward and return back in time, the Brockton High freshman football field, the Baroncelli, original Albert Baroncelli field, and also is another baseball field that was used by freshmen, Brockton High freshmen, and also softball. That existed and it was taken. And there was a promise made by then Mayor Jack Units that they're going to take the Baroncelli field and construct, which is Campanelli Stadium, Rocks Baseball. It was really, I think, a good thing to do at the time. However, a promise was made that when they took the Baroncelli field, that they then would build a new field for the boys and girls to play ball in. That promise has gone unfulfilled for over a decade. With that being said, the only thing that the city did was they put up a sign that said Albert C. Baroncelli Fields at two existing Brockton High baseball fields. That's all they did. They took a sign and placed it and said that's the new Baroncelli Fields. Now, the Baroncelli family, you know, the owners of Nemo's Market up in Ward 7, Shirley, they've done so much for the city of Brockton. And Albert Baroncelli, not just the field, but there's an annual award given in his name. The right thing to do was to discuss this tonight before the Finance Committee. The gentlemen that are here tonight are three people that give a lot of time, but so do a lot of other coaches that are here tonight. But I think at the end of the day, and Mayor Carpenter and I spoke briefly about this evening, I think we need to have a due diligence period. We need to figure out how we can correct a wrong, an obligation that was made not just to the Baroncelli family, not just to the residents and taxpayers, but to the boys and girls. So with that being said, I'd like the three gentlemen that were invited, feel free to come up to the podium to discuss this evening. Thank you.
Do not speak close to the microphone. City Council members, especially you, Bob, Finance Committee members, on behalf of myself and the Brockton West Board, the parents and players of our league, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity. As Bob said, my name is Matt O'Brien, and I stand before you as president of Brockton West Youth Baseball, the largest youth baseball league in the city. Kind of repeating what Bob said, yeah. Back in the 90s, late 90s or thereabouts, current mayor at the time, Jack Units, promised our league a new field when the city took Baroncelli Field to build the Rock Stadium, Campanelli Stadium. To date, we are still without that field, and why that hasn't been pursued up until now, I don't know. I'm not sure. Now, we have five different leagues in this city. And all of but ours have one thing in common. All their fields are at the same location. We have North Little League, who plays at North Middle School. Brookfield plays at Brookfield. Southwest plays at the Gilmore Academy. And Downey plays at Downey. This makes it easier for a parent who has a player in T-ball and a player in minors to be at one location. You don't have to juggle. They don't have to juggle between the two different locations, trying to get across the west part of the city at the same time. Okay, so I'll ask, where does Brockton West play? We play over at West. We play at the high school. We play at Trent Field, which is on Ash Street. And we play at Petro, which is over on Torrey Street. And this could seriously be a logistical nightmare for a parent trying to get two kids to two different places at the same time. Now, I did a Google Maps, and I did all four of our locations, and it took 15 minutes, and this was at noontime this afternoon with no traffic. It took 15 minutes to get from our field at Petronelli, which is on Torrey Street, over to West Middle School, over to Ash Street, and then over to Brockton High. That was at noontime. I mean, I can't imagine what it would be at 5 o'clock when parents have to get kids to the fields. This summer, actually, we had four teams enter the Suburban League, a Suburban Baseball Travel League. And we went to towns like Quincy and Braintree and Weymouth. And their facilities were absolutely gorgeous, phenomenal. And it was kind of embarrassing for me as president and embarrassing for our young ball players to have to play host to these towns, you know, on a field, you know, not on a complex as even remotely close to what they have. So I think we have we're talking about a proposal. Turn West Middle School into a complex. But, you know, there are three fields already cut out at West with enough room to make a fourth. There's a dilapidated tennis court that doesn't even be used, that could be used as two small t-ball fields. These fields don't have to be 200 feet. They could be 175 feet. And the city needs to own up to its promise that it's made to our league, it made to our parents, and more importantly, it made to our kids. Thank you for your consideration.
Counselor?
Mr. Keene and Mr. Berlini, did you have anything to offer as well?
Bill Keene, I'm the vice president of the league. I just want to thank you guys for hearing this tonight. Bob, appreciate all the work you've done. And just to echo what Bob said and what Matt said, I think just my father was actually the treasurer of the league at the time when this deal was brokered to get a new field. And over the years, I've heard him talking about now my kid's playing in the league. And I think just what spurred asking Bob to look into this again is the fact that we do see these other towns have such great complexes. And I played at Baroncelli Field. I know what a nice field it was. We've got a great location. It would be to still have that today. It would be wonderful. We have Petronelli, which is a nice field, but we're kind of hamstrung there. The Conservation Commission, we can't, even if we had someone give us $1 million to put lights in, we couldn't do it. It just, there's nothing we can do with it. There's limited parking. So I think it just got us thinking that, you know, let's look into this. I know there's been some talk in the city about tearing baseball fields down to build soccer fields. And I think that was another impetus too, that baseball is alive in this city. If you come to the fields, kids are playing baseball. And I think a complex, a new baseball field even, that's done the state of the art, would be even more driver to have kids play baseball. And it's a great sport, as you guys probably all know, and it's really alive in the city. Thank you.
Mr. Berlini, do you have any?
I don't have anything further to add.
Thank you.
Joe's been in the league since it started.
Mr. Chairman.
I can say Mr. Berlini has been there since my kids were there.
And he actually has the best tie that we've had in the chamber in a long time, that's for sure. Mr. Chairman, if I could, not to belabor this, but a promise was made, and a promise is a promise, and we need to do the right thing. And I did speak to Mayor Carpenter. We all know that the mayor, is a sportsman. I've heard people say to me, "Why bother? You know, baseball is diminished. It's you can hardly get the players." That's not what I see when I take my two boys to T-ball and baseball. And I think Mr. Keene hit it on the head. It is thriving. Maybe not like it was in the 80s or 70s, but it's thriving, and it's keeping the boys and girls, busy and active, which is a good thing. But the mayor, to his credit, when we chatted tonight, Mayor Carpenter said that, you know, he's ready, willing, and able to work with us to see if there is a location. And I think really the whole point of this resolve tonight was, first of all, educate those that are here that are watching on TV that might not have known that indeed there was a beautiful field, and Bill, I played there as well. I mean, Baroncelli Field was it. I mean, that was awesome. And when it was gone, a promise was made, and it hasn't been fulfilled. So we need to correct that, and we need to right the wrong. So with that being said, I want to thank the mayor for his opinion tonight and his commitment to work with us. And I know I'm only one of 11, but all the men and women that serve for you, and we will continue to work. So I'll give it back to you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I do want to take time to thank Councilor Sullivan for bringing this before us this evening. And as he and I had discussion just last week when we were going out the door, that if anybody had any history to this whole situation, it was myself. And sad to say that, not in a negative way, but I was a school committee member then when the stadium was being built or going to be built. And I was on the school committee at the point in time when Mayor Units had come to the school committee and asked for us to deed that property to the city. And for the reason of the stadium to be built with the conference center. But the greatest concern I had as a school committee member and other members as well was what was going to happen to the Baroncelli Field. And he's right and you're so right, because a commitment was made and for whatever reason, it was never carried out, and it should have been carried out, and it wasn't. It was Councilor Sullivan and I just a few years ago that were able to get the Baroncelli sign back in some type of a place because of the Baroncelli family, who I've known for many, many years. Fred and his wife Sheila lived next door to me when I was a young tyke, to be truthful with you. Al served as a member of the Brockton School Committee for a good many years and worked the community school program for a good many years. It was named for a reason, and we all always felt that at some point we still needed to do something, and we weren't able to do that. But and as you all know, Brockton High School and that land resides right in Ward 3, so as the city councilor, I stand behind your suggestion and your idea. I'll stand behind the mayor and whatever he wants to do, and I'll definitely stand behind City Councilor at large Sullivan and other councilors as well to make sure that we can make a wrong right, because I think we need to. And I believe, you know, comment that was made, you're right, baseball still is alive. I mean, it's a great sport. I mean, there's young kids out there. I see, you know, just at the Nelson Field down by South Middle School, which is, you know, further down, but in Ward 3, you know, they're playing ball there all the time. So I don't want to see a sport like that go away because everyone says soccer's the new sport. Baseball is the sport, and I don't think Babe Ruth would want us here to say that baseball is gone. I wouldn't think. So in any case, whatever I can do as the council of Ward 3 to work with the mayor and others, I will do that to make that wrong a right. So thank you for bringing it to our attention. Thank you.
Councilor Byrnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The second gentleman that spoke, I missed your name. Yes, thank you, sir. So you mentioned that your dad was the treasurer at the time that the agreement was made with the city and the league. Was there anything in writing, or maybe through the chair to Councilor Sullivan as well, was there anything in writing or any kind of plans, or was it just, if you allow us to do this, we will do this?
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I don't believe, Council, that it was actually formalized in like a memorandum of agreement or a memorandum of understanding. It was a verbalized promise, but it was made in public. Okay. So there's minutes and there's records that would reflect that. Okay. And again, it wasn't just a city council making that promise. It was the mayor, the CEO of the city of Brockton that made that promise. So
okay, I didn't know if there were any like funds set aside or something like that, and you know, to have
so,
to
Council.
Locate those things like that. Okay, all right, great. Well, thank you, Councilor Sullivan, and I too. I never played any t-ball or baseball, but I enjoy watching some of my friends' sons and nephews play. So anything for the kids. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Monahan.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. If nobody has any objection, I was wondering, even though he's not on the invited list, is if we could bring up the C plan of Rob May.
Yes, we can. If there's no objections, if Mr. May could step up. Okay. Keep in mind, Mr. May didn't have any preparation for this, so he may not be able to answer what you want to ask him, but go ahead.
Oh, he can answer this question. We have been using park grant to do, now we're talking about possibly some soccer fields with park grant money. We've done Edgar's with the park grant. Is it possible if we find land, maybe we can get West Union High School, it's possible to get park grant money to make a complex like that? Or is there some Guidelines.
Counselor,
you have to go by.
The state's park grant, and it's PARC, but it used to be called the Gateway Communities, Greening Gateway Communities Grant. The land that that money has to be spent on has to be registered as recreational land and held that way. So by being owned by the school district, mm-hmm. we would need to carve out property that is, I think it's chapter 91. I don't remember what the,
yes. Yep.
It is, thank yep. you. So that property that we own now at West is owned as a municipal corporation. So we would have to find land for chapter 91 land for a park grant.
Could we make it chapter 91?
It would be the city's prerogative to do that.
So I might suggest maybe we look into that. I don't know where else this possibly that they could put a complex, but if we could do something like that, use a park grant, build that mm-hmm. complex, I think that might be the way to go, if we can do it. I don't know.
That could be an alternative, yes.
Okay, I was just interested in that. Okay, thanks a lot.
Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Chairman, just in summary, I want to first of all thank everybody. And at this time, I'd like any boy and girl that plays in the league to stand up, because it's a school night, and thank you for being here. I also, I'd be remiss if we didn't recognize the coaches that spend a lot of time. If you wouldn't mind standing up as well, anybody that coaches.
Yay!
Thank you. And lastly, I think Mr. O'Brien might have hit a home run. You like that, home run baseball? But I think he did, because
right
if you go up to West Middle School and you look at what was the tennis courts, that's just vacant land now. I mean, so that might be a win-win for at least the T-ball, the little ones. So with that being said, I want to thank everybody. I want to thank the mayor. I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to make a favorable recommendation with the caveat that we will continue to pursue this as a city council, as a school committee, as the mayor, and to work with these individuals.
Second.
Favorable recommendation back to the
motion
full council.
Motion made and seconded to recommend this favorably back to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much, and thank you very much, Kim. Item number three. Councilor Sullivan? three and four, you wanted to? Oh, no,
Mr. Chair, I was going to do four and five.
Four and five, okay. Item number three, Madam
Mr. Chair, if we could we just take a two-minute recess, or maybe the since it's school night,
recess.
They might want to go home.
We're back in session. Madam Clerk, item number three, please.
An ordinance amending Chapter 20, Streets and Sidewalks of the Revised Ordinances of the City of Brockton, enacting a complete streets ordinance, invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor.
Councilor Farwell, you're the one that asked us to be sent back to, who would you like to speak to?
Let's start with Mr. May. He may be able to handle this.
If there's no objections, because we didn't actually put him on the invite list, but that's my oversight, so if you could step forward.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Mr. May. Mr. May, I don't have a particular problem with this ordinance, but I want to make sure before we jump and embrace it that we know exactly what it's going to require, particularly in terms of any financial requirements. The other thing I would say is that Brockton's an older urban community. Most of the streets have not changed in terms of their layout. Vehicles have gotten bigger. The volume of traffic has greatly increased. So consequently, what has worked in about 36 other communities who have adopted this complete streets Department of Transportation ordinance or program, I just want to make sure it's applicable here. My understanding is that there's $50,000 in technical assistance and $400,000 available to a community, but there's only about $12.6 million allocated statewide for the entire program. So having said all that, it appears as though this ordinance is designed so that whenever we reconstruct a street, we've got to apply the provisions of this ordinance, embrace bicycling, walking, transit vehicles, regular vehicular traffic. And so I guess my first question to you would be, which jumped out at me, is where would you see bicycle lanes in Brockton? On what streets? I mean, given the volume of traffic and the safety issues they present, I mean, we would be mandated to do this. And there are no design costs in the grants, by the way. The design costs would fall on the city. So where would you see this ordinance being applicable in terms of bicycle lanes, enhancing traffic, et cetera?
Well, if I could take a step back just a little bit and explain what a complete street is, and that is a street that provides safe and accessible options for travel modes to all travel modes. So whether it's walking, biking, transit, vehicles, trucks, all of those, and opportunities for all people of all ages. Now, the complete streets philosophy that MassDOT has adopted, and I should say that it's up to 136 communities that have registered their interest in complete streets, and several more have gone through. There's 92 who have submitted policies to the state at this point, and that's off of the state's website today. The philosophy of complete streets or the ordinance that we're looking at requires us to consider complete street elements when we go to rebuild a road, repave a road, working with a developer who wants to do a subdivision, things like that. So the key word is consider. In some cases, any particular road may not be able to accommodate bus traffic, truck traffic, bicycle lanes, added sidewalks, but it wants us to look at it, to really give it the old college try, and does it make sense to add sidewalks in places where we don't have sidewalks? Does it make sense to, or can we accommodate ADA accessible ramps on our streets when we rebuild them? There is a way, if the cost of providing a single element exceeds the value of which the project, for which the project is, we can exempt that project. And I want to ask Pat Ciamella from OCPC is here with us also, who is an expert on complete streets. But there are, as you saw, various elements. We don't have to use all of them on every road, but when we go and repave, use our Chapter 90 money to repave a road, does it have curbs? Does it have sidewalks right now? If they don't, Can we fit curb and sidewalk into those locations? Does it have ADA accessible crosswalks and ramps? Are there traffic calming measures that we could do on roads where we have very high speed traffic or a lot of pedestrian accidents or even fatalities? So it's an optional system. We need to really consider what we can do to improve the safety of that road. And then if it's affordable to us, then we should move forward and do a project like that.
Well, the only thing is, and this is just one section out of the proposed ordinance, and it's section 10. The city shall review and either revise or develop proposed revisions to all appropriate plans, zoning and subdivision codes, laws, procedures, rules, regulations, guidelines, programs, templates, design manuals, and the citywide comprehensive plan to integrate complete street principles in all street projects on streets. Now, I'm not an attorney, but when it says shall, it would seem to me that if we adopt this ordinance as written, what we've said to the state is that in every street project, even if we would, let's take a street up in Ward 6 that hasn't been paved in years, if we were to reconstruct that street, we would have to apply all of the complete streets components in terms of the design, the layout, and incorporate that into that street reconstruction. And the reason I raise this is that there are people who are begging just to have their streets reconstructed. They're not interested in sidewalks, they're not interested in bicycle lanes or buffer zones or center lane plantings. They just want their street repaved. And if I'm misreading this, please let me know. But it seems pretty inclusive that even in the citywide comprehensive plan, we have to integrate complete streets principles in all street projects. And that kind of dovetails into my next question is that if we would do a street and it adds $20,000 or $25,000 or $30,000 to that street, depending upon the length, that will chew up the available funding for street reconstruction rather quickly. And so that's my cautionary approach to this. Not that I don't think that we should be doing all this, and I'll get on a little bit into the record keeping that's required of the DPW and our current workforce. But that's my concern. It looks like we're wedding ourselves to this requirement on all street projects, and will there be increased costs? I mean, if you put in a sidewalk, particularly with granite curbing, I know the cost escalates rather quickly. And I don't know what other communities have found out. And that might be something we'd want to look at. And in the other communities that have adopted this, have they seen a considerable increase in their street reconstruction projects? And I don't know that.
I would like to point out that our current roadway guidelines from DPW do require curb and gutter. Our current subdivision regulations require curb and gutter and have adopted a complete street philosophy, so any new roads that are going in. What this is asking, though, is that on any planned project that we have currently underway or on future projects, where we have to consider using complete streets and making that evaluation and how we improve the safety for all people on that street, whether they're walking, whether they're driving, whether they're riding their bike. And if I, with your permission, if I could, I can't call somebody, but Pat Ciamello
like
would be a...
If there's no objection. Mr. Ciamello, if you could come up.
Thank you for having me here tonight. Just to get back to your question, I think the whole thing behind this is to look at streets. You know, I know you have a concern about the Chapter 90 streets where you have a limited amount of money where you want to do some work. But again, it's all if it's feasible to do within the required requirements. But this is what we're gearing towards is more that the streets that are being done with federal aid and state aid, like for instance, the main roads that we're doing, like Belmont Street, West Elm Street, those are all being done now anyway. We, anytime there's a new construction, we considered putting bike path, not bike path, but bike ways to it, because they used to break down the shoulders where you see the line. And in some cases, it's just a matter of putting a line there so that you differentiate between where the cars are and where, you know, the bicycle, or in some cases, the pedestrians are walking. This is an opportunity, and then there is $50 million over 5 years, $12 million the first year, and then the rest is being divided each year. You know, this is an opportunity to be able to get some, you know, you mentioned about the cost, $30,000. Most of that is in the construction, and the construction will be paid through either federal government or the state. So on the main roads, if that's, you know, the main part that you want to really look at, you know, they consider that when they're doing the design, but the construction cost is borne by the state, and basically. The city usually, what they do is pay for the design of that particular facility. Some of the major projects that are being done in Brockton are through the federal government and the state. So in that particular case, you know, it's not much more cost to the community. It's mostly the design work, basically.
But well, it's a maximum $400,000. If we pass this and we do everything right, we get $400,000. And it's not yearly. It's a one-time $400,000, right. Correct?
But you could apply the second year. What you have to do is develop a priority plan that shows where things are going to be done.
Yes.
And, you know, you can apply once. But I think in the future year, you can also, in the future, you might be able to apply additional funds. Like I said, this is just a pilot program to get everybody going. And like Rob mentioned, there's over 100 communities that have signed up on it. I think it's a good thing for the community here.
But am I correct that if we were to do a street using Chapter 90 funds, where there is no current sidewalk, there's no bicycle lane. Frankly, there's only a few streets that have, I call it a fog line, but a bicycle lane. No markings there. We would have to incorporate that into the design and construction, reconstruction of that street. Am I correct?
If you're doing a full reconstruction to Chapter 90s, and I don't know that you do that many in full reconstruction. You usually do a repavement on that, on those particular streets. I don't know if you do a lot of reconstruction.
Well, we have done some full depth excavations. And,
Chapter 90?
With Chapter 95. I mean, I certainly did some while I was in office. And that's my concern, is that we're all begging to have streets done, and I don't want to adopt something that drives up the cost only to find out that expends money faster than we were before. But
again, it's all if it's feasible, too.
Well, but this doesn't say that. It doesn't say where feasible the city shall review and either revise or develop. It says this is what you're going to do on all street projects. So let me go on a little bit so that I don't take up too much time here. But there's a lot of verbiage starting on page 6, on my page 6. The Department of Public Works shall create individual numeric benchmarks for performance measures as a means of tracking and measuring performance of the program. Percentage of transit stops accessible via sidewalks, rate of crashes, injuries, fatalities by mode, rate of children walking or bicycling to school, vehicle miles traveled, a single occupancy vehicle, trip reduction. Are we going to be able to, and Mr. May, you're really not able to answer this, it would have to be Mr. Rowley. Go ahead.
I think we do that now anyway. We keep track of all those. This is a way for the state to keep track of all the projects, how they're doing.
Okay, even on our side streets. If we were to do, Algonquin Ave up in Ward 5, are you telling me that you have those statistics for Algonquin?
You just do
the primary roads, am I right?
We do all the federal aid eligible roads.
Right, but not the side streets, not the...
Well, the side streets, if they're eligible for federal aid, we have some of that data. And what I'm saying is there's a lot of roads that are federal aid eligible.
East Ashland Street.
That's federal aid eligible.
Okay. Court Street.
not sure Court Street is.
Well, and again, that's...
Any major connect the roads of what they consider federal... I didn't bring a map with me that shows me...
No, I didn't expect you to. All right, let me move on to the exceptions, EX, approval process. And Mr. May, this seems to set up another level of bureaucracy. It says there'll be a formal exemption review panel established, representatives from the planning department, the traffic commission, a city council member, Old Colony Planning Council, members from the pedestrian and bicycle advocacy community to hear complete street exemption proposals. And then there should be a public hearing to hear opposing views against project exemption. So that whole new level of bureaucracy, why can't that be handled by the traffic commission? Why? I mean, that's composed of representatives from the city council, planning board, traffic. Why set up a whole new level of hearings, bureaucracy, record keeping, minutes?
Mr. Chairman, can I just point of information to my colleague? This, a lot of this does come before the Traffic Commission. I know we did, we saw plans on West Elm Street and where the bike paths, so they are involved in the process. I'm not sure, but there is involvement. It's not just the ordinance and the...
This ordinance would overrule that, I would believe.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Just a final question then, Mr. May. Go ahead.
If I can answer that, though. This is template language that was developed by the Mass Municipal Association and the Department of Transportation.
Yep.
There are some communities in Massachusetts that do not have traffic commissions. I think if we wanted to amend this language, we could say that the Traffic Commission is responsible for reviewing exemptions, if that is the pleasure of the council.
Would it be acceptable with you, because I would like to see this pass, but in some form that we make sure we haven't perhaps jumped too soon, would it be acceptable to you to hold this until the next Finance Committee meeting? I can submit a couple of proposed ordinances to you and have you look at them?
I think so. No. I thought they did by the end of the month.
Yeah, I did too.
I think we are running up against an application deadline. I believe it's the end of the month, and Pat has pretty much concurs with that. We've been working on this for a while in committee. If there are some recommendations, I think if we could... I don't know how to facilitate that conversation.
No, I mean the conditions.
Mr. Chairman, just a point of information. Is it possible to offer an amendment tonight?
Absolutely.
And see if we can move this along. If they're under some time constraints, then I'd like to make a motion that with respect to Section 5, exemptions, subsection B, that item number 1 be amended to read, the Traffic Commission shall hear appeals for exceptions from the Complete Streets Ordinance provisions. And I'll try to write that out in a minute.
I need you to write that out, okay. And do I have a second on that?
Second.
Second.
So if you could write that out, and okay. Motion is made and seconded to...
Pardon me.
Oh, were you about to say something?
No, I was coughing.
Oh, okay. Motion made and seconded to amend Section 5, Subsection B, under 1, the formal exemption review panel shall be the Brockton Traffic Commission.
Yep.
Correct?
Yes.
And that would strike from the city's planning department, Brockton Traffic Commission, which will stay, the city council member, the Old Colony Planning Council, and a member from the pedestrian and bicycle advocacy community to hear complete street exemption proposals. Motion made and seconded on...
Mr. Chairman, on the motion.
On the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I sit on the on Traffic Commission, and to be honest with you, I think the way the Traffic Commission is currently composed, I see that commission being given additional duties in the sense where, in reality, they don't really have the staff nor the personnel to carry out some of these things. So I think instead of just you know, making a motion and jumping onto a motion, if we could perhaps hold off on that motion and introduce it at our next regular council meeting, so that we can kind of really look at every single piece of information that we need to, other than just kind of push through an amendment, just so that we can push this thing forward. So I think it probably makes sense for us to hold off at least until our regular scheduled city council meeting to introduce the amendment, because I don't see how, you know, sitting in traffic that, you know, with this, all this additional work that will be done, and the way the traffic commission is currently composed, I don't think it actually makes much sense.
Okay, currently we have an amendment on the floor, properly seconded. Is there anyone else wants to speak on the motion? So we have an amendment on the floor. Does everybody understand the amendment? Mm-hmm. Amendment properly seconded. All those in favor? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All those opposed? The amendment passes. Madam Clerk, do you have that the amendment written?
And Mr.
I have pieces of it. I'll get it from.
Okay.
And Mr. Chairman, I have one other very small one, and that's Section 3, Subsection 10. Insert the words, whenever feasible, the city shall review and either revise or develop proposed revisions to all appropriate plans, etc. And that's in keeping with Mr. May indicating that this is supposed to be an ordinance that's applied practically. Mm-hmm. It's not supposed to be a burden to the community. So.
I'm sorry, Section 3 and whereabouts?
And it's subsection 10. Under definitions, section.
I don't see under Section 3 or subsection 10.
Yeah. It'd be page 5, sir.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
You can't believe that's Section 4.
10?
Section 4.
It's in Section 4, I believe.
No.
Under implementation.
One, two. Oh, it's Article 4, I'm sorry. Section 3, definitions. Article 4, yeah.
Section 4, subsection 10, correct?
Yes.
So in Section 4, subsection 10. And could you give me that again now?
Yes, just insert the words, whenever feasible, the city shall review and either revise or develop. So just insert those two
following streets at the end, whatever.
No, at the beginning, where it says the city shall review and either revise, the words, whenever feasible, the city shall review and either revise or develop.
Is there a second on that?
Second.
So motion made seconded to place an amendment under Section 4, subsection 10, that the city shall review when feasible and either revise or develop proposed revisions. Correct?
Yes.
Anybody want to speak on the motion?
On the motion.
On the motion, Councilor Sullivan.
I could through you, Mr. Chairman. Councilor, I mean, from a legal perspective, when feasible is pretty vague. There's really no definitive there. I mean, I believe the intent would be you don't want it to be burdensome on the municipality, right?
Yes. I'd certainly withdraw the motion if you have a better suggestion.
Chairman, I'll echo the sentiments of my colleague, but I will also have a caveat to that. So it was when feasible and not to be overly burdensome upon the city, comma. That's in the form of a motion.
Second.
Well, we have a motion. Councilor Fowle, did you want
to
withdraw?
May I accept that as a friendly amendment?
Can you withdraw your amendment?
I'll withdraw my amendment and ask my colleague to repeat the...
the amendment would say when feasible and not overly burdensome upon the city, comma.
Could you write that out, please?
I got it for you.
You got it, thank you. That's motion.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to amend subsection 4, section 4, subsection 10.
Sign it with me here.
Anybody want to speak before we vote? I'm sorry, you can't.
I know.
All those in favor?
Use the raise his hand.
All those opposed? Amendment carries.
Other one, Brian. Here's the other one.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, colleagues.
Now, before we vote.
Thank you, Counselor.
In total, does anybody have any other questions? In that case, I'd entertain a motion.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council as amended. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you,
gentlemen.
Thank
you. Mr. Chairman.
Counselor.
I'm going to make a motion, if we could, to take agenda items 4 and 5 collectively.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take items 4 and 5 collectively. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, could you please read items 4 and 5?
An ordinance amending revised ordinances of the City of Brockton, Chapter 5.5, and accepting Mass General Law Chapter 40U in its entirety. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nezrelis, City Solicitor. And the Chapter 40U of the Massachusetts General Laws B, and hereby is accepted by the City of Brockton in accordance with the General Law Chapter 40U, Section 2. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John Condon, Chief Financial Officer, and Philip Nezrelis, City Solicitor.
Good evening, Mr. President. Good evening, councilors. I would just like to make some brief kind of overview remarks regarding this, and then we've got the solicitor and one of the assistant solicitors here to talk about the legal stuff. 40U, I mean, the basis for this is something we've been looking at for a little while before bringing it forward. I recall several months ago, I think now, Councilor Farwell and I having a conversation about 40U. And this relates to code enforcement, which I know is a very important issue with the council, and councils have made that very clear. I believe that adopting 40U will allow us to be more effective enforcing city codes and ordinances. Currently, when our code enforcement people, and it may be a building inspector, it may be a health inspector, outside code enforcement officer, when they issue a civil fine, or what we call a green ticket in triplicate, it is issued, once we issue it, it goes over to the Southeast Housing Court. And our only mechanism to actually be able to enforce and collect those fines is through the Southeast Housing Court. Now, I do have a little personal experience with this, because I think, as most of you know, I did work as an outside code enforcement officer for 2 years before becoming mayor. And I spent almost every Tuesday and Wednesday over at the Southeast Housing Court. And it is frustrating from the city's standpoint, and we do not collect a whole lot of fines over there. Mm-hmm. We write a lot of fines, but we don't collect most of them. And the reason is that the housing court is what they refer to themselves as a court of compliance, that they view these fines as not being intended to be punitive, but rather to motivate someone to come into compliance. And the reality is that by the time we write a violation, the person has a 21-day appeal period. The court takes another anywhere from 4 to 8 weeks to set a hearing date after that with an assistant clerk. And you get there. It's a couple months since you wrote the original ticket. And if anywhere along the line, the property owner has taken steps to fix the problem, the court dismisses the ticket. No matter how much expense or time was expended by the city to get that person to that point that they were coming into compliance. And I hate to say it, but I believe we do have a small group of irresponsible property owners here in the city who know how the system works and make a conscious business decision to do things their own way, knowing that in many cases the ultimate cost of the enforcement is a fraction of what it would have cost them in the first place. So it takes the teeth out of the system. We can write the fine, but enforcing the fine, and then taking it one step further, now the assistant clerk upholds our ticket once in a while, and then the person doesn't pay. We have no mechanism to collect other than to start in small claims court, and then we have to file a small claims court action, and that's good for another two or three trips over to the courthouse to finally maybe get a judgment for the fine. So it's a very burdensome, time-consuming, and I don't think very effective way to collect on the civil fines. So what the 40U would allow us to do, we're already doing a lot of 40U with the green tickets and the triplicate, but what it would allow us to do is to take the hearing portion back in-house, and the city would be able to appoint a hearing officer. Instead of sending these tickets over to the Southeast Housing Court, we would be able to administer themselves. Now, the statute does provide some guidelines about having to have some nighttime hearing hours available and things of that sort. But I believe we could expedite the process, make it a lot faster. It would give us the ability, if the hearing officer upheld the fine, would give us the opportunity as the city to just add it to the property tax bill rather than having to go through a whole small claims court proceeding afterwards if the fine wasn't paid. And I think it would also allow us to be much more effective on the enforcement. I think our own hearing officer, understanding that we're trying to work with our residents and our property owners, and I think we would look to have a very probably lenient posture on a first offense and really try to work with someone in fully understanding what they need to do to comply, but with a clear warning that in subsequent offenses, you're going to pay the fine. And I think we could get a lot more compliance. The attorneys have done a lot of research. I'll allow them to answer specific questions, but I'll share with you that one of the cities that adopted 40U fairly recently was New Bedford. They just adopted it in the past year or so. And in prepping for tonight, I reached out to Mayor Mitchell down in New Bedford to ask him what his thoughts were on 40U so far. And he said, let me get his exact words right, he's very satisfied with the results so far. What I'd like to quote him as saying is that it gave the city a good lever against bad landlords. A good lever against bad landlords. And I think that's in the interest of our residents, the quality of life of people who live here. We have a lot of good ordinances. We have a lot of state codes to enforce. And we're really well positioned to adopt this now. Now, down the road, I mean, I think the only main expense incurred early on is the cost of a hearing officer. My personal opinion is that we should use someone from the outside. I don't think it should be a city employee or a city department head, because I think that would make residents feel as though we were judge, jury, and executioner on these tickets. And I don't think that's what we're looking for. I think we want to provide people a fair hearing, because in a fair hearing, we're willing to work with anybody who's willing to work with us. But for those small percentage of folks that are really not willing to work with us, we need to be able to bring the hammer down once in a while and collect some fines and have that be the motivation to business people that choose as a business decision to not comply with city and state ordinances and codes. So I believe this would be a very positive measure. Boston's had it for years, several other cities. But I think New Bedford is a great analogy because we're similar to New Bedford in many ways. They just enacted it within the past year. They just actually implemented it a few months ago. But Mayor Mitchell is very positive in terms of how it's working out for the city of New Bedford. So I would ask you to please give this your due consideration. And we've got the solicitor and the assistant solicitor here to answer specific questions for you. Thank you.
Who recommended this come back? Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr.
Do you want
Mayor.
Me or do you want them? Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So, councilors, I sent this back. I thought it was appropriate to send it back to FinCom so that we could have legal counsel here tonight.
I mean, I'm not opposed to this in any fashion. I think it's actually another tool in our toolbox for blight and for code violations. But as I said before, I personally witnessed another municipality adopt this. It was enacted, and it wasn't very effective, I think, in the carryout process. I did speak to Attorney Nazarella, and Attorney Bartlett called me as well today, and I thank you. I do have a few questions. I think for more information purposes, it was great that the mayor, and it was on my list, an independent hearings officer makes so much sense. It kind of gets any political ramifications out of the mix as well, and it's done in a proper way. I also spoke to the attorney about conducting it after hours to make sure it's friendly to the residents, the people that are aggrieved. But at the end of the day, it's definitely something that should be worked out because it's considered prima facie evidence in a civil proceeding. And ultimately, and Attorney Nazarella can clarify this, but ultimately, if someone doesn't pay the fine, it's a municipal lien on their property. The city's not in the position or in the business of taking people's houses, but it could if taxes and obligations aren't paid and penalties. So with that being said, Attorney Nazarella, if you could just maybe explain to me and again to the councilors how you, from a legal perspective, see the legal ramifications of adopting this. We heard from the mayor, and it sounded really great. My big concern was the financial ability to hire a hearings officer, number one, and then the legal ramifications of a person. It's my understanding under 40U, if they're found, say, guilty, they have the ability to go to district court, appeal to district court or to housing court. The $10 under 5.5-3, the additional penalties, if it's not paid within 10 days is an additional, 21 days is an additional $10 processing fee, and then another 10 bucks additional penalty if it's not within 30 days. I know that one of the other issues in the abutting municipality was the actual notice being posted at the residence. But I also interpreted it, and I reviewed it again today, under the Mass General Law, it does allow the City of Brockton, if we adopt this, to revoke, suspend any license, permit, or certificate issued pertaining to the real property in question. So that has some teeth as well. So with that being said, Mr. Chairman, Attorney Nazarella, could you just from a legal perspective explain to us, if I haven't done so, and I probably haven't, your thoughts on this from a law perspective?
Well, I think it's an excellent step in the right direction to expedite the process that up until this point in time has really had no teeth. It has ramifications in a positive fashion, both financially and procedurally, in the sense that instead of having a city personnel going and being lost in the hallways of the district court, awaiting for an hour or two for a hearing, going before a magistrate, and it's almost a revolving door situation where warnings are given, they extend second, third, fourth chances. Those people who tend to ignore the law and also ignore the good faith extension by the court find themselves back in court together with our code enforcement officers and lawyers. So it's a colossal waste of time and money. This process that we're adopting brings it into within the city confines. The municipality will be holding the hearings by a disinterested outside person whose fee we have not yet negotiated and resolved, but I can ensure the city and members of the city council will be a very fair and reasonable one. And we can expedite the process by putting the lien on the property. We can also probably 90% with assuredness have the mortgage holder will pay that if it's a bank. So the likelihood of the monies and fines being paid is exceedingly high. And as you indicated earlier, failure to pay is prima facie evidence for other licenses that debtor may hold. So his other licenses may be affected. And when this hammer of reality falls on his or her head, they'll realize that payment of these fines is exceedingly important. Up until now, code enforcement has done their job. It's just that we can't get the final resolution by the payments. They don't take it seriously. When they find that these fines will end up a lien on their property tax, they'll certainly, as we say, come to the altar and I think do their part. And even more important than the fines, they will see that the remedial action is done so we don't have a blight on the city by properties that are unkept, snow and ice on the sidewalks that are not taken care of. This ordinance and statutes takes care of a number of issues, negative issues, that sometimes homeowners allow to accumulate.
Thank you, Attorney. Two quick questions. Relative to the municipal hearings officer, do you, not to hold your feet to fire, but do you expect that person, that man or woman, to actually be an officer of the court, an attorney, or do you think that it doesn't have to under general law, but what do you think?
At this point, it is my intention. That's what I'm working on, and I'm talking to a few people who are officers of the court, attorneys, and I'm doing that because I believe they can focus in on the issues, they can read the law to them, and to use a cliche, maybe even the Riot Act, that this is serious business when they're before them. And I think their knowledge of the law and executing the law will make it much more timely and cost-effective.
Excellent. And my last question would be, relative to the additional penalties, I know the other municipality did per diems. The way that this is written, that's just a flat fixed $10, correct?
That is correct, and that's regulated by the statute. Until after the third offense, they haven't paid, then we are allowed to exceed that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And as also a follow-up to what His Honor the Mayor stated, we had checked, the law department checked with the law department in New Bedford, who I have some colleagues down there, and they felt it's going exceptionally well. Attorney Bartlett checked with the town of city of Chelsea that is finding a great deal of success with this program.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councilor Nizarella, I just have a few questions about the order in of itself and then some things that I would like to probably present. So this $10, is it in Section C, is that daily or is that just, I know that Councilor Sullivan said it's a flat rate, but is it a daily rate that they
No.
Okay, can we make it that way? Is that something that,
No, that's
not
regulated by state statutes.
Don't you go to the same
rigmarole?
Oh.
$10?
Is there a way to up the price? Or make
No.
it more punitive?
I agree with you, Counselor. It's not a big price, but the fact that this goes on to the, it becomes a lien on their taxes will be the effective aspect of it. It's really a vehicle to put a lien on the property.
Okay.
But we have no control at the local level to supersede what the state statute regulates.
Okay. And is there, once, say for instance, somebody just, they continue to be negligent and then the property has to have a lien filed on it. Is there a cost for filing the lien?
There's yes. There's if it's recorded at the Registry of Deeds, there is.
Okay. Can that be added on?
We get to that point. That can be added on.
Okay. Does that need to be written in here so that nobody's shocked?
It's stated in the. It's stated.
Chairman, point of information. It's a $75 fee at the Registry of Deeds to record that. $75.
And that gets passed on.
Yeah,
to
it'd be a pass
the delinquent
through.
Party.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's stated in the statute, the one that we're adopting.
Okay, great. And when, okay, so the mayor said that originally these things came through the court, and you said it as well, that, you know, take a few days in court and going back and forth and all of these things. And these
it takes a few months in court.
Oh, okay, a few months in court. So is there a process to having it come back to the city? Do we have to withdraw something from the court, or can we just kind of start taking over
our
own hearings?
No, we handle it internally. We handle it internally.
Okay.
And they'll be notified by documents that are prepared by the city as to what their rights are, what their time obligations are.
The offender?
That's correct.
Okay, all right. But there's nothing that we need to do to sever the adjudicative process of
No,
the court.
Once we have adopted the ordinance, the statute, then we take it from this point.
Okay. And with the independent officer, so you stated that you've actually been speaking with several of your colleagues.
Colleagues meaning lawyers.
Lawyers.
I haven't completed that process, but I'm trying to narrow it to some people who are familiar with municipal law in these particular ordinances and statutes.
Okay. I would like to, I guess, maybe amend this or offer an amendment that the decision on who the independent officer will be will not be solely left to the law department. I think that the council should have some kind of confirmation of appointment in some way, as we do other positions, not quite
like
this.
I think that's beyond the scope of council's authority.
Exactly.
Okay, how is that so? So if somebody's coming to work on the behalf of the city and we have no idea who that person is, what their qualifications
this
are?
This is an appointment made through the mayor's office that does not need confirmation. I'm just giving the procedural aspect of how this runs.
Okay, I get it, but I don't understand the rationale. Why?
I can't explain the rationale. That's just what the procedure is.
Okay, then I think I can present that as an amendment. Well,
one rationale, Counselor, may be to depoliticize that whole process as well.
Counselor, what I recommend to you is we can do what we need tonight, and you can talk with our attorney before next Monday, before the final vote would be taken.
Well, talk to Mr. if we're Gilday talking again. About it now, and then it goes before the council next week or whenever we have next council meeting, it'll be too late because it'll be adopted.
No, we could table it or postpone it next Monday night. All I'm saying is we need to get our decisions from our attorney.
Okay.
The city's attorney is saying he doesn't believe it's legal. I think what you'd want to do is ask Mr. Gilday, who's counsel for the city council, if that's something you could offer as an amendment. You could still offer the amendment next Monday night.
Okay. Okay.
That's all I'm saying is it's not final until we vote on it next Monday night. So you'd be able to offer that amendment. I would recommend, you know, the city solicitor is saying it's not legal. We have our own attorney for that reason. I would recommend you talk to him tomorrow.
He didn't say it wasn't legal. He just said it was in his opinion that he thought it was out of the scope. So
correct.
Okay.
Not part of the, I'm not saying illegal, but not part. I would recommend you ask that question of our attorney.
Okay. All right, I'll do that. That's fair.
And you'd still have up till, you know, through next Monday night to either postpone or to offer the amendment.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Israel.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Council Monahan.
Yes. Good evening, Phil.
Good evening.
I thought I heard Council Sullivan say that they can appeal to the district or housing court again. Is that true?
That is correct. They can appeal the decision by the hearing officer to a court of competent jurisdiction, which is the district court housing court.
Yep. Okay, so does that start a whole process again? Like,
no, it's a hearing de novo, meaning they have a new hearing and they go before the court as they did before the hearing officer.
So that's not gonna string it out longer?
Well, yes, if they appeal it and they go to another hearing before the court, it would string it out.
Okay. All right, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Studetsky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Evening. Mr. Solicitor, how are you?
Good evening.
I think it's a wonderful piece of legislation, but my one problem, how do we take care of the snow and ice problem with an elderly person or a handicapped person who cannot physically clean it up? Do we teach common sense to the people who are doing the enforcement? How do we do it?
Well, I think there's always a combination of common sense, but every person who owns property has an obligation under the law to maintain the property. The state statutes that talk about snow and ice removal don't discriminate over age or gender or any other line of demarcation. It's an obligation.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is the citation will go out even to the person who owns a piece of property, lives in it, and he's in a wheelchair.
Well, again, that would be up to the discretion of the code enforcing officer.
Okay.
Trust if he sees an elderly person disabled or challenged in physical activity, he or she would work accordingly.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anyone else? Councilor Farwell.
Yes, good evening. I spoke with Solicitor Nasrallah earlier. I think it's a very good step forward for the city. We did talk about the fact that there will be actual dockets that are published, so everything will be transparent. I think code enforcement in this particular program has to be fair, impartial, and compassionate, and it definitely has to be depoliticized. And I say that about us. I say that about any other city official, whomever that hearings officer is. We can't be involved in making a call, even though it's not a courthouse, we can't be involved in making a call saying, look, you know, it's a friend of mine, it's a political supporter, the program has got to get off on the right step, and again, be compassionate, fair, and impartial without any political interference, because if you get politics into it, it's not gonna work the way it should, so.
I agree with that 100%.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Chairman, I'm gonna make a motion, but I also just to you as the chair. I was wondering if we could check with the clerk. I noticed both orders are not executed, signed by a counselor. It just said the word counselor. So I don't know who the main sponsor was on both of those items. But with that being said, I'd like to make a favorable recommendation. We took 4 and 5 collectively. So favorable recommendation of both 4 and 5 agenda items back to the full city council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend items 4 and 5 to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommend it favorably.
Thank you.
I will check with the clerk tomorrow.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, I'd like to make a motion at this time. Due to the heat, I'd like to see the gentleman and ladies is wearing a jacket. Be allowed to take the jacket off.
Anybody would like to remove their jacket, they may.
What?
Item number 6.
Resolved that the chairman of the Board of Assessors report to the City Council on the process and steps followed in assessing the value of homes in the city. Invited John O'Donnell, Board of Assessors Chairman.
Councilor Beauregard, I believe you filed this, correct?
Yes, I did, Mr. President. Thank you. I thank you, Mr. O'Donnell, for being here tonight. There was a couple of things here. The idea was to have Mr. O'Donnell come in front of City Council to present options, for example, for individuals that qualify, and to have a process to inform individuals about how they could qualify. And this came about because at the beginning of this year, people were rather alarmed by their tax bill because the value of their homes had increased. And in many instances, these were individuals that lived at their homes and purchased them for much less than they are now valued at. And a lot of them are older or retired on fixed incomes. And that was one of the concerns. So the reason I ask that we do this early and in the process is so that we could work out maybe a plan to have opportunities, a workshop, etc., and a decent amount of time during the day or in the evening or maybe a Saturday where individuals could come and ask the questions they need answered and see if they qualify, and if they do, how they apply for the process. Because I know that's time sensitive. And I realized that what had happened the last time we had the presentation at the Arnone School, many people had questions, and then there was one or two evenings where the assessor's office was able to be opened for a certain amount of time, and then after that, the deadline was over. So it's one of the reasons. Since then, Mr. O'Donnell has forwarded some information to me on what is a personal exemption, what are the qualifications, various requirements, different individuals that might qualify, or what the requirements are for them to qualify. So at this point, I just let him speak on that, and then I'll open up to my colleagues. Thank you.
So you're looking to qualify for an abatement?
Exactly.
Well, that was part of it, yes. And the other part was, we were curious as to find out how the values of the homes were assessed. And we realize that it's complicated, but maybe just a little bit of an understanding. So people, again, that purchased a house in 1965 for $30,000, and now that house is going to go for, $320,000. That's a big, difference in the value of their home and how they, begin to understand that process. Right. Thank you.
So we're looking for how the homes are assessed is what you filed.
Yes, and to understand how, because of the way they're assessed, how the people can qualify. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. O'Donnell.
Good evening. actually, she asked me to talk about abatements and exemptions, so I can.
We'll give a little leeway here.
Okay, and I'll go through.
Technically, that's not what we have in front of us.
I understand. Leeway. So abatements can be filed beginning January 1st, the third quarter bill, and they have 30 days to file an application. And the Board of Assessors has 90 days to act on the application from the date of the application. So, and then after that, a homeowner, if they don't agree with the board's decision, they can file with the the appellate tax board, and they have 90 days to file with the appellate tax board. Do you want me to keep go on the exemptions or take questions on this, or how do you want it?
Why don't you keep going with the exemptions, and then right, we'll take questions afterwards.
All right, so personal exemptions are a privilege established by the legislature for the release of discharge a taxpayer from the obligation to pay all or a portion of his taxes. Exemptions can be filed starting July 1st, the first day of the fiscal year, and the last day to file would be 90 days after the third quarter bill, so it's basically April 1st. So a homeowner would have 9 months to file. My office sends out, we sent out 1,100 applications in August. The various personal exemptions we offer are Clause 41C, which a taxpayer has to be over the 70 years of age and as of July 1st, 2016, must have a primary residence in Massachusetts for 10 years and own the property in the state for 5 years. They must have occupied the property as of July 1st. They must have an income of less than assets of less than $28,000 for a single person and $30,000 for a married person. And the income has to be less than $17,500 for a single and $21,700 if married, and that's after subtracting out allowable exclusions. This person, if they're approved, they would get a $500 exemption from their tax, and they'd be entitled to $280 trash exemption. Clause 41A is a deferral of taxes. A taxpayer must be over 65 years of age, and as of July 1st, must have a primary residence in Massachusetts for 10 years and own the property in the state for 5. Must have occupied the property as of July 1st, 2016. And they can defer any portion of their taxes, a third, a quarter, the whole tax. And the city charged 8% interest on that deferral process. The next one is a Clause 17D. The taxpayer must be 70 years old as of July 1st, must have owned or occupied a property in the state for 5 years, and they can have a total asset of less than $40,000. And their exemption is $175. Veterans are Clause 22. They must be a veteran, and veterans 10% disabled to 99% disabled are entitled to a $400 exemption. 100% disabled veterans entitled to a $1,000 exemption, and a paralegal gets 100% exempt from taxes, and a surviving spouse of a service member who died as a result of service-connected injury or disease is 100% exempt. And the last one that we, or the last two are, is hardship. It's Clause 18. The homeowner has to be 65 years of age, and they can have an income of up to $24,990. They have to prove, and this is, the board hears these cases. It's there's not many people that apply for it. They have to prove their poverty. So they just come in and they give us all their bank statements, whatever their reason for. This clause is basically for people, it's not for people to come back year after year after year. It's for someone that really has a hardship and we can help them with their taxes. And the board can give as much as they want for an exemption. And the last one is a 37A for blind, and they get a $500 exemption.
Thank you. Councilman Monahan.
Yes, good evening. Good evening, John. How are you doing?
Good.
Is that all available on the city website?
It's all on the website. It's in our office.
Okay. And do you send any of that out with the...
We had a veteran come in today that he had no idea. His girlfriend works over at Council on Aging, and she found out about it. He's entitled to a $400 exemption. So,
Do we mail out that information with the building?
Oh, yeah.
So if we have it online and all that information.
Once a person files every year, we mail out an application back to them the following year.
Okay.
So we sent out 1,100 applications this past year.
Right. And on the abatements, as we've been held probably, I don't know how many years, we've hosted like 4 or 5 of them. It gets to be, when it's January, we've held them. But I don't know how much time they have to do it, but it's sort of a short window that they can actually do it.
30 days.
Yeah, from what, when they get the tax bills in January 1st.
Exactly.
So, I mean, we try to do it once in a while if they're interested in it, but all the information is on the website.
Yes.
And now, is that information with the abatements, is that mailed to them also?
No.
That is not.
It's right on the tax bill.
It tells them right on the
tax
bill.
It's on the third quarter tax bill.
I don't pay my taxes. My wife does. Anyway. All right. Thanks a lot, John.
You're welcome.
Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. O'Donnell.
Good evening.
My question is about the abatements. I am familiar that it's a very short window. And last year when we had one of these workshops, yes, we do give, we do give the residents the information. But I feel that, and I've done the process once, we do make mistakes sometimes, but I brought it up to you, I believe, that night at the Arnold School. We have a lot of capable volunteers that would like to come in and just help people, because it may seem easy to us or somebody that's done it before, but it's not easy for everybody, and sometimes just the process scares them away. And I saw a lot of people leaving that meeting last year very frustrated, because they had multifamilies, they were assessed, you know, higher than what they felt they, you know, they were paying a lot more than
the taxes were more,
right?
Assessments were,
yes,
you know, that's
so to explain this to them. But I had brought up
volunteers
that
volunteers could help, but okay. The 3 members of the board and the 4 girls in my office, we cannot help.
No, that's understandable. But I remember there was, we had residents there that were knowledgeable and that had offered to come in and maybe during certain times during that window to offer to help people that are coming in. So I just would suggest to take them up on that. I know it was.
No, realtors have helped people before.
Okay, but I think if we do it on our end for the city, so they don't feel that they have to go pay somebody.
No, they'll volunteer their time.
They're volunteers. Well, maybe getting that information out to them. Just.
Okay.
I felt like people seemed to back off and not go through the process because it seemed like it was too complicated.
Yeah.
We had 550 applications, which is a lot. So they applied.
Okay. But I know that I heard from a lot of people that were a little frustrated. So if, we can direct people that would like to volunteer.
Sure.
I think that would be great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hello, Mr. O'Donnell. So there's been a resident that's been contacting me for a few years now about his particular piece of property. He said he spoke with you a few times. I won't mention his name, but he's having a problem with interest. I guess he had some problems with the delivery of his bills. They were going to a previous address, and now I think you may be familiar with who I'm speaking about.
Very familiar with them.
Right. So, you know, the way the story was told to me is that, you know, he wasn't receiving his bills. He'd spoken with someone in very high esteem in the city. They agreed with him that he should probably get some kind of break or abatement, but for some reason he's not eligible or something of that nature, and he's indicated to me in one form or another that it's the interest. So how, and I may have missed it when you were reading some of the qualifications, but how is interest dealt with regarding abatements or anything? Is that even addressed or no?
No, he can't. He didn't pay his taxes. So can I talk to you after the meeting? I'll explain.
Yeah,
the
right. But no, that's what I'm asking.
We don't talk about individual.
This is not the problem.
I'm not. I'm asking about interest. How is interest addressed with abatement? Is that even addressed on there? That's what I wanted
no.
to find out.
No.
Okay. Is there any way that how does that work? How does that accrue?
His
I guess
property was in tax title.
Well, no. I'm just asking about interest. How does interest accrue on situations like that?
That would be for the tax collector. You'd want to get the tax collector in here to talk about.
Oh, okay.
That.
All right, because I'm okay.
That is not on your assessment. That is something a tax collector would have to address.
Okay. All right, great. Just
point of
just
information
asking.
To my colleague. Interest accumulates daily on our tax bills and at a very high rate. I don't want to give it. It's at a pretty high rate daily. And if they do file an abatement, it is.
The taxes have to be paid.
That it, I'm sorry? The tax have to be
that's
paid.
That's one of the requirements. That your
right.
Taxes have to be
paid. But if you file an abatement, the city does not credit you back money. It just fixes it for the future, I believe. There's...
No, you get your credit back.
You get credit back?
Yeah, you get money.
But I think then it's fixed. That's what I was told, that it wasn't, that we don't, they don't go back and credit interest. I mean,
no, interest is something put on by the tax collector's office yes. on a past due bill. Not, has, doesn't have anything to do with the assessor's office.
Okay. Okay, we'll talk later. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. O'Donnell.
Good evening.
I think you did a great job with the summary, especially the senior circuit breaker. That was great. In terms of the veterans, I only had two quick questions.
Sure.
In terms of the veterans, are you also seeing, and it's I think more on the treasurer's side, but this body adopted the volunteer for the seniors and the veterans. And I was just wondering, is like that individual that came in today to see you, the veteran, are you seeing any of these veterans also taking advantage of that as well?
There's only three.
Only three, huh? No. We got to fix that. And then lastly, the notice that's going out from your office to explain this, because it's complicated to some people.
On the exemptions?
Yes, on the exemptions. Is it in multi-languages?
No, we don't. We only send them out once someone applies.
Once someone applies?
Okay. Yeah. So no, but we could put on the website that way.
Multi-language on the web?
Yeah.
Yeah, that might be helpful. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Farwell.
Good evening, Mr. O'Donnell. We can't expect you to know all of the different answers to the questions we may have. So at the end, when everyone's spoken, I'm going to ask that this resolve be postponed until maybe late November, because I think you'll have the information back from the latest revaluation. Am I correct?
Reval's done. Completely.
Okay. I do have a problem with some abatements. And I have to tell you, I understand Lowe's took us to the appellate tax board. Am I right? The mall?
I can't really talk about...
Well, the case is decided.
I can't talk about it.
I beg your pardon?
I cannot talk about it.
You can't talk about Lowe's?
No.
And the reason for that is?
It's a state law. It is chapter...
Aren't abatements public
Abatement
record?
The book is public record, not yeah. the application or the file.
Well, I'm not asking for that. I'm just saying, did they take us to the appellate tax board?
We settled with them prior to going to the appellate.
We did settle with them, yes, that's correct. And so my problem is that in July 2011, they spent $12,500,000 for 16.14 acres of land and a couple of buildings up there.
Wasn't
a now, let me finish.
Transaction.
And now we have them assessed for $10,483,000. And so to some of us, we're saying, well, how can a piece of property in the mall?
Because the assessment, an assessment of an individual building is not based on a sale price. It's based on group sales. It's mass appraisal. It's not like someone going out and appraising your home. When we appraise house, when we assess houses, we take a group of properties. It's a group of data. We don't take individual sales.
But the sale price is based on what a willing buyer and a willing seller will.
That was not an arm's length transaction.
I beg your pardon?
It was not an arm's length transaction.
Are you comfortable with the fact that apparently that property is only worth $10 million after they spent $12,500,000 for it?
It's not an arm's length transaction.
I don't
we
know.
We can't. It's not a valid sale.
It
was not a valid sale.
It was not a valid sale?
No. No.
Okay, the deed is recorded.
I have the deed, and I did the research on the deed.
Okay.
Campanelli, I don't think this is a proper venue
well,
to
talk
about
this. Well, it's an abatement that's been granted.
I'm not supposed to talk about how the abatement was granted.
So you're telling me that the assessor's department of the city of Brockton,
yes.
having granted an abatement to Lowe's department stores, you are now precluded from giving the city council or the residents any information about how you arrived at their value?
You can look at the
abatement. Attorney Nazarella, could you kind of explain this?
Yes, under the state law, we can talk about whatever is on the front desk, the abatement book, and what the results were if an abatement was given. But to discuss the process of how the assessors arrived at a particular abatement for a particular applicant is outside the scope of what is allowed. We can't even discuss the contents of the application or related documents.
It did go to the Appellate Tax Board, and there were filings made, correct?
It did not go to the Appellate Tax
Board. Oh, it didn't go to the Appellate Tax Board. So the city independently on its own decided that it was not an arm's-length transaction and... Well, I don't understand
it,
your
was not, it was not litigated in the Appellate Tax Board. It was a negotiated resolution.
By the city?
That is correct.
Okay. And in fact, for the record, is the assessment that's listed on the assessor's card, $10,483,400, the current value, even though the land was purchased at a higher price?
If that's what's stated, yes.
Well, Frankly, I do understand that some legal proceedings are secret. They have to be so that you can reach some type of a compromise with the parties. But after the case is concluded, unless there's some agreement between the parties that you will forever withhold that information, quite frankly, on an issue like this, I don't understand it.
I understand your point, but that's the DOR will support this position.
Okay. Well, then I'd like to go on then to other reasons why I'd like to have Mr. O'Donnell come back. Overvalued property, 1151 Main Street, which has 17,982 square feet of leasable space and about a fifth of an acre of land. And
Councilor,
that,
I don't think I we can't can talk be into about individual pieces of property tonight.
I can't ask him how he arrived at this figure?
No.
Can you explain, what we were here for tonight is to explain the process. If you want to explain the process of how numbers are.
If you have 2 hours, I can explain the process.
Then just a point of information, if he can't explain the process for how he arrived at a value assigned to a particular piece of property.
How can I, if I have no research, how can you expect me to remember that piece of property?
Well, I don't expect you to remember it. I was going to hit you with the value of it and ask you in your professional judgment, is a piece
that
of...
Is that fair to me?
Is it fair to ask you your professional judgment?
If I have no research done on it? I mean...
I have the information here.
I don't have it.
I can give it to you.
Well, again, if I may, Mr. President, I think it... and I can respect what Councilor Farwell is making inquiry of. However, under the DOR regulations... And you may check this with Mr. Gilday. He is precluded and prohibited from discussing the process at which he arrived at a conclusion for a particular applicant.
I would recommend the same thing we talked about earlier, Councilor. You're going to want to table.
I think so because
we can discuss that with our attorney. And
my final comment to everyone is: we have residents who would beg to have a $300 or $500 or $1,000 abatement on their property so that they can make ends meet. And here we have commercial properties which seem to be doing fairly well in the overvalued abatement process, and I'd like to find out why. If we can't do it in this forum, so be it. We'll check with our legislative council. Thank you.
Council on this. Anybody else? Council Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I want to thank John O'Donnell for coming this evening. And what I hope we're going to get out of this is, you know, it's obviously various steps. And as my colleague suggested, Councilor Azak, what I'm hoping is that we can work with volunteers and other individuals. I realize several of the colleagues this evening have mentioned that all this information is online. Part of our situation we ran into is a lot of these older individuals are intimidated or don't even work on a computer. And they're the ones that are feeling the financial challenge the most. And that's why we wanted to have individuals available and this documentation. This I appreciate because I'm going to, again, turn around and photocopy this, bring this to the Council on Aging, and keep this in various information areas. And as my colleague Councilor Sullivan mentioned, yes, we definitely want to see that our veterans that have served us well should have be able to take advantage of this opportunity, and because many of them are coming back financially challenged after their service. So I want to thank you very much, and move to postpone the resolve, but to speak with your office again. Thank you.
Postpone till when?
I'm sorry, we had discussed postponing
last
it till
meeting in November.
Okay, thank you.
And do I have a second on that?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to postpone this item till the last meeting in November. All those in favor? All those opposed? Last meeting in November. Any other business? We'll be back in next Monday night for council. We're adjourned. So fine.